standing by.
Good morning, everybody, and welcome to your sunset safari on this Sunday, the 24th of June. I think it's the 24th of June. I don't know why I'm talking like I am talking. Good morning. It's the 26th of June. That's why my voice was about 2 days behind the rest of us. We were just driving quite quickly so that we might show you an animal at the beginning of this drive. There they are. They are live, as this show is completely live from the midst of the African wilderness here. In the northeast corner of South Africa, you're on a live safari, like I say. The sun has yet to peep up over the eastern horizon. This is a herd of wildebeest, or gnus, and you are most welcome with us. My name is James Henry. On camera today is Wim Durenbach. How are you feeling today, Wim?
100.
Very nice. He's got some blue gloves on, which I think probably at least 20 years old.
Out of my school gloves.
Your school gloves. Wim, of course, well beyond school-going age. On the other vehicle, the beefy figure of Byron the Buffalo Sorrel, and he, of course, is being filmed by the equally, beneficent figure of Brian. I use the term beneficent, of course, not because I know what it means, but because it has the same starting letter as Brian. They are heading to the north. Now, this morning, we heard lions calling somewhere around here. We found tracks of a single female around here somewhere. But with all of these wildebeest here, it is unlikely that there are too many lions around. As I say that, they've stood up and they're now looking quite intently in one direction. So maybe there's a lioness around here. Please do talk to us over the course of the next 3 hours. Hashtag Safari Live. If you're on Twitter, questions at wildearth.tv if you want to use the email. It's 8 degrees Celsius, so it's pretty chilly out here. I think that's 45 degrees Fahrenheit or 48 degrees Fahrenheit. Which is, of course, not very warm, and many of you will be experiencing a delightful summer in the northern reaches of the world. We are experiencing a rather delightful winter, so while it's a little chilly to be out in the morning, the sun's about to peep up, the sky is totally free of clouds, and I think we're in for a really beautiful day. And all around us, the very gentle winter dawn chorus has begun. Hear the sparrows, choop, choop, choop. One or two hornbills. I wonder if these wildebeest haven't seen a lion. Let's just go a little bit forward. You may have heard one of them going. That's normally a sort of sign of alarm, and they're all looking in the same direction. If you are a new viewer, you are most specially welcome. Please do feel free to talk to us, ask us about what we're seeing, ask about what we might see, ask about the country, ask about Africa. We'll be more than happy to try and address any questions or queries or entertain your comments about what we are seeing or what we might see or what you might expect should you be privileged enough to come out here to Africa. By Africa, I do mean, of course, anywhere on this vast continent. I'm just going to stop a little bit over the hill here and look down towards the valley. It's quite nice up here. We're on pretty much the highest point, one of the highest points on Juma. Now, Juma is the little piece of spit of land that we call home, which is on the western fringes of the Kruger Park, and it's quite warm up here. As soon as we descend into the valleys, it's when it gets rather chilly. I don't see any sign of any kind of predator. This is where the wildebeest were looking. They may have just caught something on the wind. But my general intention today, everyone, is to go down towards where Karula was last seen. That was yesterday. Her cubs weren't around. She was on the hunt. So let's go and see if she's killed something. and maybe her little cubs will arrive. And for those of you who are new, Karula, a 12-year-old female leopard, she provides the bulk of our leopard viewing. Magnificent female that she is, and we really have spent much, much fruitful and fun time with her over the last few years. All right, VMP, shall we press on? Yeah, let's press on. Right, let's go and find out from Byron what his plans for the morning are. I will see you a little further down towards the south.
Good morning, everyone. Thank you, James. My name is Byron, and with me on camera this morning, I have Brian and the thumb. Is the thumb out this morning, Brian? Oh, the thumb is out. It is a very cold morning this morning. We have been searching for any lion activity. I heard lions early this morning. It must have been around 3 or 4 o'clock. I heard at least 2 different sets of lions calling. I'm not too sure. It was very difficult to gauge which direction, but we are going to try our best to see if we have any tracks or any sign of these lions. I'm hoping to find you a male lion this morning. So we will try our luck, but it is very chilly. As you can see, the beanie, the gloves, it's a nice, cool 8 degrees Celsius. I think a lot of the animals are possibly still hunkered down, trying to stay a little bit warm before they start moving. As the morning starts to warm up, you'll probably get a lot more animal activity and animals moving around. But it's not too bad. Brian has got quite a few layers on behind me. Blankets, scarves, beanies. James did have tracks of a lioness, he mentioned. Not far from camp, and that's possibly one of the lions I heard earlier this morning, but he says they were heading up and down and then headed north, and I think I caught a glimpse of those tracks crossing our boundary on our way into this area. I'm kind of in the central part of Juma at the moment. Some fresh elephant dung over here. Let's see. And yesterday morning there was a leopard calling in the area, and last night, those of you who were watching, we followed a lioness, a very pregnant lioness, right across in front of me on this road, and she headed off in this direction. So hopefully in the next week or so we may have signs of a few cubs that have been born. Trying to check the road carefully for any tracks, anything that we could potentially try and follow. Lucy from Indiana would like to know if, while we are driving and we're using the spotlights like we did last night on that lioness, do they react to their shadows if they see it? Lucy, from what I've seen, I've never seen an animal, a lion or leopard or anything, react to their shadow. You know, I think we need to also remember that when they're walking during the day, they will see their shadow regularly. So it's not a case that of them never had seen their shadow before. So from what I've seen, they've never reacted to it. I think they obviously know that is their shadow, perhaps. You know, again, we don't really understand the full capacity of their intelligence, but I think these animals are far more intelligent than we actually realize. But good question. We also try and be very sensitive when we are shining the spotlights on the animals. Never try and shine directly in their eyes, because the bright light can often just affect them a little bit. You see them squinting, just like we would if we had a spotlight shining in our eyes. So we are very, very careful, and we try not to blind them. We'll shine just off of the animals, whatever it may be, lions, leopards, any nocturnal animals, just so that the light doesn't bother them too much. James Richard, thank you for your comment. James Richard has said that if anyone can find a cat, it seems to be me. Well, we've been lucky the last few days. We've had cheetah, we've had leopard, and we have had lions. So thank you, James, and I'm glad you're watching so avidly. And it's always great to have your comments and questions. I'm going to try my best this morning again, and with Brian's eagle eye behind me, maybe we can spot something. Don't forget, everyone, we are live, which is incredible. It is amazing that you can join in from all around the world and watch a live safari with us. While I start heading off towards Biffle's Hook Dam, cross over to James and see what updates he has for you.
While you were away, everybody, the sun peeped up over the eastern horizon, and there it is, framed beautifully by a tree. And shining gold in the dust that we raised up as we drove past there. Isn't that pretty? Just have a listen to what's going on. Again, the winter dawn chorus, very, very quiet. One or two doves. Black-headed oriole. Choo! Choo! It's no mean feat getting Viam to film the sunrise, I have to tell you, everybody. He demanded action today. He said, I want to see action. Well, we'll do our best. So we had some, this is where we had the lion tracks, and I've just noticed that they've turned round and come back this way. And I'm not going to follow up on her. I don't think that they're that fresh. So we're going to carry on round and see if we don't have some luck with the leopards. Now, Deborah Armchair Traveller, you are as confused as the rest of us. You say you don't know how many Nkuhuma lionesses have cubs and how many are pregnant, and it's all rather difficult. I agree with you, it is all rather difficult. We know that at least two, well, yeah, we know that we have only seen one with cubs. That's on Torchwood. She's got three. But we do know that at least two others of them, sorry, at least one other, is definitely lactating. She's walked around and been walking around. She was at the kill yesterday. She's got very swollen nipples, and she definitely seems to have been feeding cubs. Somewhere in the drainage systems around the Mulwati drainage line, we haven't managed to find her. She goes in and out of there into really inaccessible areas. So I think it's at least two that have cubs. And then yesterday, we've been watching another one and thinking that she's pregnant, and Byron was just agreeing yesterday that that third lioness is probably also pregnant. The other two, I'm not sure. It's entirely possible that they're all pregnant. But so far we know that two have got cubs then, and one is probably about to drop another litter fairly soon. Now, 6 weeks, of course, before they'll be introduced to the pride, and therefore 6 weeks before, unless they're in a den site around a place like First Rock on Torchwood, where we know it's easily accessible to vehicles and we know where she is, unless that happens, you often don't see the cubs until they start to move with the pride, which will be at about 6 weeks. So I know it's going to be a little, it's very frustrating knowing that there are cubs around the place, but it's just a waiting game, like so much out here, a waiting game when we'll be able to enjoy them. We're going to go west along this road for a little while and then turn south and see if we can't pick up some other tracks of the leopard and whatever else there might be. Hello, share his vision. That's quite a nice Twitter handle. You say this is your first time watching, you don't feel tired at all. Well, that's good. I'm glad you don't feel tired. Graham, do you feel tired?
No.
No. Energized by the African dawn. That's probably why you don't feel tired. And by what?
12 hours of sleep.
And by 12 hours of sleep, yes, Graham, that does help. Graham likes his sleep. But share his vision. Great to have you along. Thank you for your time, and thank you very much for getting hold of us. Please continue to talk to us and send us your questions and your comments. And maybe one day you too will come out here. We had a wonderful, it's always nice, a viewer yesterday on an Arethusa vehicle very subtly went past and said, instead of sort of saying, "Oh, I watch you all the time," which sometimes some people do, which is also very nice, he just kind of winked at us and said, "Watch you every day, keep up the good work." And that was really, it was really kind of touching to have that very subtle woman on the back of an Arethusa vehicle. And she's out here because she watched these shows. And I just think that's wonderful. The more people that come out here and share our experiences in the wild, the greater the chances these last wilderness areas have of being conserved. It's going to ease down this way, and then we'll turn south. Watching the tops of the termite mounds. Now the one, I know this landscape to many will seem quite harsh as the leaves start to fall off the trees. The grass is obviously very sparse at the moment, but it is much easier to spot things through the thin bush without its leaves than through the thick bush in the summertime, which might look verdant green, but it's often a lot harder to spot animals. Right. Vim, are you having your coffee there, are you?
Uh-huh.
Vim likes to bring with himself a picnic. What else have you brought today?
Just coffee.
Just coffee. Oh, dear. Things are tough in camp, hey?
Yep.
And no fruit?
There's only apples.
There are only apples. No. Apples are the lettuce of fruit. As lettuce is to vegetables, so are apples to fruit. Let's go across to Byron and find out how far east he's got.
James, I haven't quite crossed the boundary yet. I'm not too far east, but we are heading towards Biffles Hook Dam. We're driving through a bit of a drainage line at the moment. Still very little activity, animal activity. And as I said, it's still cold, so it does take the animals a bit of time to move around. You know, they feel cold just like we do. But you never know. It's always potentially something waiting around the corner. I'll just make sure I watch the road carefully. It becomes an art driving and talking to guests behind you and keeping an eye on the road. And don't want to hit a bump and lose a guest or a cameraman for that matter this morning. So Chris Rogue, he says, if I am able to find a wild cat or a serval, I'll have the cat title. Well, let's see. You never know. I haven't seen a serval for a very long time. They're very, very shy cats, very elusive. Beautiful, beautiful cats. Scanning very carefully here while we're driving through this thick bush. Don't want to miss anything. Also trying to glance at the road and see if we have any tracks. Sun is starting to rise just beyond the trees. I think another few minutes and we should get a beautiful sunrise. So Marianne from Arkansas would like to know if I have visited North America, and if so, what wildlife did I see? Marianne, and I have visited North America many, many years ago, and unfortunately the only wildlife I saw were New Yorkers. I only managed to get into New York, so it was a different jungle for me, the concrete jungle. But I found it fascinating. Beautiful place. Love New York. Love the vibe, the atmosphere, just the energy. So I'd love to get back there at some point. But then if I do go up to North America, I'll try and get into some of your national parks that you have, which look beautiful. Yellowstone. What are the other ones? Let's just have a look. We're approaching Biffles Hook Dam here. Just in time for sunrise. Look at that. I don't see any activity here at the moment. Not even our resident hippo, it looks like. Possibly still off feeding or making its way back towards the water. But look at that sunrise. And this is also photographer's dream. I think if you have a tree like that in front of the sun, you get a beautiful silhouette, just like Brian is showing you there now. It's very, very nice, very beautiful. It also helps to stop and listen like this for a while. Maybe we get any alarm calls from some of the animals in the area, impala or kudu, or we hear some of the predators with their territorial calls. This is not a bad place to stop at all. Very beautiful morning. There's a woodpecker, a bearded woodpecker, knocking away in the distance. Georgia Ann from Illinois has said even though she has missed a few years of episodes with Safari Live, she now has 620 images of Brian's sunrises. So well done, Brian. And that's really great that you were Brian's son. Oh, thumb. Brian's thumb is very famous too. It's not just the sunrise.
I have to say, that's quite spectacular. Holy moly.
620 images of Brian's thumb. Oh, fantastic. Oh, dear. All right. I think while the sun is rising, we are going to make our way around this area a little bit more, see if we can get any tracks. While we do that, James has some buffalo for you.
Now we are here with a breeding herd of beefaloes. That's not the extent of it. The extent of it, look at Viam's artistic revelation of the herd of buffaloes. It just starts to get moving in the sun. Now, what's interesting about this is that it's a typical winter's scene. The buffalo don't like to be too cold, and so during the night in the winter they huddle together like the penguins in Antarctica, all trying to get towards the middle, and then as it starts to warm slightly as the sun comes up, they'll start to move and they'll go grazing and see what they can find to eat. And eventually they'll make their way down to the water, probably mid-morning, have a drink, and then go and lie up in the shade and chew the cud. Sounds like a good Sunday, don't you think, Viam? Mm-hmm. Late start, nice breakfast, pleasant drink, cud chewing in the shade. It's a really lovely herd of buffalo here. Nice extent. Probably about, what do you think, Viam, about 150 or so, maybe? There's a young one thinking about life, pondering the strange thing looking at them as the sun rises. Oxpecker already up, eating ticks, picking at the holes, picking at the scabs. I'm just going to quickly talk to Andrew, who's hailing me on the radio. Go ahead. You can hear him if you want.
Lucas, open area. Say Gary, man, but yeah, maybe you can confirm. Running on the eastern channel.
Okay, copy, thanks. Which open area? So they found a lion somewhere.
Lucas, open area. Probably close to that junction, Weaver's Nest area. They say on Gary Main area.
Okay, copy, thanks. We'll head down that way. Thanks, Andrew. All right, so there seems to be a lion somewhere to the south of us, but quite a long way to the south. Let's just enjoy these beefies for now. This is wonderful. And of course, as they get up, as just about with all the animals, when they start to move after an extended period of snoozing, they have a little bit of a box. The young males, you'll hear their horns knocking together. They'll rub each other. This is reaffirming social bonds, that kind of movement, pushing each other about the place. Get all the dust gathering. I think that's lovely. And now, watch, this is democracy in action. Here we see democracy, everybody, believe it or not. The oldest females will pick the direction. You can see some wandered off behind the screen there, some wandered off towards us, some wandering off now to the right-hand side. And basically, there will be a democratic vote from these buffalo, and they'll decide whether or which direction they're going to go in based on where most of them think is a good idea. Which I always think is quite interesting. This is great fun. Buffalo in the misty morning. Nice view. Mm-hmm. I mean, I know buffalo aren't your favourite. Belching, of course. Coughing. Oh, the light is just too beautiful now. Now, let's watch where the democracy takes them. Gary, you're interested in what time of year is the best for safari. Gary, there's no real best time of year. Every time of year is good fun, and it just brings different things. So in very broad strokes, if we take the seasons, let's start, let's say winter is May, June, July. Winter is nice because the vegetation's a bit sparser, animals a bit more easy to spot, and the temperature's quite nice. Although it's a little bit chilly in the mornings, you don't get the blinding heat if you do the summer. So now they've decided that democracy is going to take them off in a southerly direction, and off they go to find some grazing grounds to the south of where we are now, which I think they've been spending quite a lot of time in. Then, Gary, if you go into the springtime, August, September, October, I've got something in my eye. Then what you find is that it's still very dry, and the landscape can be a bit harsh, but the game viewing is absolutely incredible because the water is so concentrated, so the herds get big, they move to and from water, it's quite predictable, but it can be quite hot as well. And it can, if you're not used to the kind of landscape, can seem quite harsh, but it's still a great time of the year to come. Then I suppose the summer months, November, December, January, very hot. You get the magnificent thunderstorms that come through here. The place is green and stunning. It's the lambing season, so you've got all the little young calves and lambs, and of course the associated predators that might want to try and eat those calves and lambs. So that's then. And then after that, sort of, we go into the height of summer, moving into autumn, would be February, March, April. Also a very good time. Quite hot. Water starting to drop off. Very green in the area. It's probably the most beautiful, visually, the most beautiful time to come. So it really does depend on what you want, I guess. But there's no bad time to come, and there's no best time to come. Righty, let's leave these beefies as they head off towards the south and see if we can't find that lion. So you heard Andrew saying that there is a sighting of a lion going to the south of us. I think it's probably just south of the road, but visible from our side. So we'll just ease our way into that area and see if we aren't lucky to find a lion there. Goodbye, beefies. This is quite... Stop doing it. He was just scratching himself there. Roger, you're in Florida and you're wondering about what likes to eat these things and if there are ever attacks on buffalo by lions. Many. Roger, these lions love to eat buffalo. And there was a hapless calf who was killed yesterday by two lionesses, and they finished her in short order. But yes, buffalo certainly take a hammering from the lions, especially the big prides. They're excellent meat. Not easy to kill, but a lion, of course, an apex predator out here. Very nice. Interesting one from you, Virginia. It's a very astute question. You say, it seems to you that more buffalo are caught by lions than wildebeest. And is that a question of, or why is that? Is it a question of the availability, or what is it? I think availability is a big part of it. There are not that many wildebeest in the area. It's not an ideal habitat for wildebeest because it is quite thick woodland in many areas here. And that thick woodland is not ideal for them. Wildebeest like open areas and grasslands, and that's why there's so many of them in Tanzania, more than there are buffalo. And so there are definitely more buffalo here, which I guess would then lend itself to them being eaten more frequently than wildebeest. I think also, I would say that's probably almost entirely what it is, because the wildebeest here do take a hammering every so often, and certainly, VMP of the hyena on the left there. Just asking my tracker what tracks we've got there. Well done. Lots of hyenas. Virginia, wildebeest do take a hammering. And this year they did really well. They've raised, certainly all of them. I think our little herd of 10 or so produced 10 calves. And those calves survived into their third month, all of them, which is really impressive. And I think it's probably because the lions were concentrated around water in other areas. So they would sit up at Bivelshoek Dam, Sydney's Dam, for example, where the wildebeest weren't. The buffalo would have to come down. And during that lambing season, because there was no, there was so little rain that there wasn't water everywhere else, and the buffalo got hammered during that particular period. There was at one stage, I think there were 5 or 6 buffalo kills on the go around here between the males and the females and a couple of sort of nomadic prides that came into the area. And they left the wildebeest alone. So yeah, Virginia, in a very long-winded way, I'd say you're absolutely correct. What was that? Lion crossing. Going where, Viam?
From the right.
To the left. So you see, he gets quite uppity if I go over the tracks. Does Viam? Do we have to go further back? I can see hyenas, Viam. Best not be wasting my time now. It looks like the lion's about to cross north up into Vuyatela. So I'm going to carry on. I'm sure it's the same ones there, Viam. In there? Okay. All right, let's go across to Byron. Let me try and figure out what's going on with the sighting here. We'll catch up with you just now.
Well, sounds like James has got something potentially going on down there, which is fantastic. Hopefully he gets to show you some lions. It sounds like they have found them. They're just trying to work out what's going on with that sighting. We have not yet had any luck. No sign of any fresh tracks. We had some tracks of lions around Bivelshoek Dam, but they were from yesterday, at least yesterday, if not earlier. And it's quite easy to tell, or not easy, but after a bit of experience, you get to gauge how fresh certain tracks are quite quickly. As I walked around, I had a look for a few little things. Some of the tracks seemed very clear, but what I saw and what I noticed was some bird tracks going over the lion tracks. So that's a good sign. Those bird tracks could have been from yesterday afternoon or early this morning. So, you know, you wouldn't necessarily get a lot of bird tracks over the lion tracks in the evening unless they are nocturnal birds. But those look like dove tracks, so that would have been yesterday afternoon or early this morning. So Shamsun has asked an interesting question. Shamsun would like to know, is it difficult to tell the difference between hyena tracks and wild dog tracks? So it's not really. The thing is with wild dog and hyena tracks, and let me see quickly if I can find it in a book here for you. I've got a mammal book and I think I've got the tracks in there. So the main difference, what I can explain firstly, is obviously the size. The hyena track is much larger than a wild dog. Wild dog track is a very small, slender track around that size. And a hyena, we just saw hyena tracks coming down here, and it's a nice round or elongated track, but about that size, especially the front paws are much, much larger. So they are a lot bigger. And then let me just see, they both have a double lobe almost at the back of the pad. So if you have to look at my hand, for example, you would have the fingers or the toes of the animal, and then the palm of my hand would be the pad. So with wild dog and a hyena, they have a W shape at the back, unlike any of the cats that have three lobes. It goes 1, 2, 3. So it's very easy to identify cat tracks. Let me see. Here's an example just of a cat track. What's easier for you there, Brian? Is that all right? There we go. So you can see that those three lobes clearly at the back. Now, this is a leopard track. So do you see that? Very, very clear. Three lobes. Lion and cheetah both have those three lobes at the back. You can see the four toes. And let me just find you a hyena and wild dog. Here we go. Here's wild dog. There we go. So that is the wild dog track. You see it's much flatter at the bottom. Only two lobes, almost like a W, goes in and out and around. Do you see that with the four toes? You're also able to see the claws on dog tracks and hyena tracks. You see the nails, the claw marks or the nails. Whereas with the big cats, you don't see that because they have retractable claws. However, with the cheetah, you can see it. You can see that. Let me just have a look for a hyena for you quickly. There we go. And here we go. This is a nice picture of a hyena track. So again, you see the back pad. It's just got that W, that just the single indentation, not three like the big cats. Four toes. You can see the claws really nicely. But look at the size difference. So that wild dog was about 70 to 75 millimeters. A hyena is about 96 to 100 millimeters. So much, much larger for the spotted hyena. So the size is definitely a key to telling the difference between wild dog and hyena tracks. But very good question. So thank you, Shamsun. It's always great to get questions like that. And while we continue our search, James is with the lions. Cross over and see what he's got.
Look at that, everybody. Elephants coming through the sunshine. I think that's a fantastic shot. What do you think, Viam? Mm-hmm. Elephant silhouetted in the dawn light. Beautiful. I took a picture of him. Do you think it was a good one?
No, it's probably overexposed.
I think it's probably overexposed and blurred. Now, unfortunately, we can't follow them off-road, but I just wanted to quickly show them to you. There could be others coming out of the sun. A but I don't think so. I think they're all finished. Now, there is a lioness, we have found out, coming this way. So we're going down to that area. Well, let's have a quick look at these elephants. I find the smell of elephants deeply comforting. Not sure why. It smells like sort of sweetish leather, but it is utterly distinctive. What do you think, Vian? In case you heard that, didn't hear that utterly sardonic comment from him, I don't know, is what he said. Okay, chaps, we're going to hurry up. There's some youngsters, there's some young cubs with these lionesses. This is very exciting indeed. They are still south of us, but it sounds like they're coming this way. Lex, confirm there's space for me to come into that sighting. Go ahead, Lex. Copy that. Confirm my best approach, Weaver's Nest. So Lex is just telling me where to come. Okay, copy, thanks. On my way. All right, we've got a good chance. She's got cubs with her. It must be Styx Pride. I haven't seen lion cubs for way too long. Since the last Styx Pride had little cubs, well, the last cubs of the Styx Pride that were subsequently, unfortunately, murdered by the Birmingham boys. Now, these are the Birmingham's first offspring. Right, I'm going to drive quite quickly, everybody. We're probably about 2.5-3 minutes away, depending on the speed of Wendy and the Dawn. Wendy, of course, this recalcitrant old bag that we drive around the place. I think a rather too generous name. While I'm racing along here, let's go back to Byron so that you don't get seasick as we go.
So I jumped the gun a little bit there. I thought James had got to the lions already, but always nice to see an elephant. So while he's racing, you're back with me and we're going to see. We still have not had any luck yet, but the morning is warming up beautifully now. It's really, the temperature's changed quite a bit and it's beautiful. Sun shining through the trees. The colors are incredible again. So I'm happy to just drive around and enjoy the scenery and wait to bump into something. Still having a glance around at the road, hoping to spot any sign of animal, any tracks that we might be looking for. I've seen a lot of hyena activity. There's definitely a large hyena population in this area. There's hyena tracks all over, but they do cover large distances in the evenings. With them being scavengers, they've got to constantly move around trying to find food or scavenge food from other animals. They do hunt for themselves, but primarily in this area they do scavenge. So Daisuke, I hope I'm saying that correctly, has asked, while we are searching for lion tracks, is there any clues or signs that we might be looking out for as opposed to just driving around blindly looking? Well, it's difficult to say. There are always signs that you try and look out for. Okay, for one, the tracks is would be the first sign, but leading up to that, you can have other signs and other key elements that you can take into account when looking. So for one, I don't know if you remember earlier I mentioned we heard lions last night. So if you hear lions, it it does help if you can try and pinpoint which direction they're coming from. So that can give you an idea of where to start looking. You head into that area, so that's one clue, is by hearing them. The other one is then while you're driving, perhaps listening out for other animals' alarm calling at lines. So if you hear impala or kudu or any antelope species, they have got distinct alarm calls for predators, especially lions. So you can listen out for alarm calls. And then again, then it's just hopefully getting into the right area, looking for any signs, any tracks, and dung possibly. Fresh lion dung on the road, that will also help you gauge whether or not the tracks that you're following are very fresh. So yeah, good question, very good question. But I would say the first thing that you, if you're lucky, you have lions calling, that will put you in the right direction. Brian and I stopped earlier and tried to listen for any sign of animals, any calls, but we didn't hear anything. We had a lot of bird activity, birds starting to get more active now as the morning is warming up. But no animal calls yet from what we heard. Also the thing is we're in a very, very large area, so animals could be calling in other places. Okay, so James is with the lions now. Go and have a look.
Look, everybody, little lion cubs. How special and precious is that? Four little lion cubs. I think they're going to go south again, out of the reserve. So let's just enjoy the sight of them. Oh, I'm so tempted to go. We're going to try and go a bit closer, but I'm afraid I don't. They're all going south now. And now they're playing, oh no, you know, there are too many people here. We're just going to wait here. But we've got a wonderful, wonderful view of them. Oh, wow. Isn't that nice? That's just fantastic. So it's a little bit confusing now because, of course, we're right on the boundary, so it's difficult to know how many vehicles are in and out of a sighting like this. So we're just going to wait here. There is another lion nest to the north of the road. Let's just stand by here. They are still there. But I'm not going to push into the sighting. It looks to me like there are two ages of cubs there, two very little ones. So we do try and keep the vehicles just, I know there are a few new people watching today. We keep the vehicles in the sighting to three. In an exceptional situation like this, where we're on the boundary and the sighting's been controlled basically by the southern, the people operating on the south there, you can get a situation where suddenly you have four. But because we've got a long lens on the camera, we'll just wait here and see what happens. I don't think it's going to be possible to get too much more of a view, to be honest. But at least we saw little lion cubs. That was very special. And they were apparently about to come to the north. And they've turned around and gone back south again, unfortunately. Yeah, I'm afraid that's going to be it, everyone. We'll sit. I think it's worth my while, and therefore worth your while, just to sit here for a little bit longer and see if they don't come back to the north. But I can't get any closer to them at this stage. I can hear some impala alarming there. And I can hear the lioness calling the cubs. Boo, 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 boo. And there is another lioness to the left-hand side of your picture, apparently inside Vuyatela. Or Juma, but I'm not going to go up there. I just don't want to put pressure on them. Beautiful. Hooray. Now, for those of you who don't know, this pride, the Styx Pride, had three, I think it was three cubs, when the Birmingham boys took over this area. Now, you know, many are put off or certainly are scandalized when they hear about the fact that when new male lions come into an area, they'll kill all cubs under a year old. And those cubs at the time, I think, were about 6 months when they were killed by the new marauding Birmingham boys. And then we didn't have any cubs for a long time. And the Birmingham settled, and the lionesses of the area, there are two prides that they dominate, the Styx pride and the Nkuhuma pride. They all settle down, they've mated with the new males, and their cubs are now starting to be born in quite a lot of profusion, actually. There are quite a few very pregnant females around the place. So with any luck, there'll be lots of cubs fairly soon, and we'll get slightly more regular viewings than the one we just had there. The two Matimba males, who were the two dominant males of the area, still living, still very big, still very magnificent, and they're lurking down around Londolozi area. They seem to have created a territory for themselves, roughly the same size as this car, but they've carved out a life for themselves there, and unfortunately their genetic legacy is probably not going to be passed on anymore, because they don't dominate any prides. They're just kind of living on their own. I think that's it, everyone. I'm afraid. Let's just see what's going on here, because I know there is a lioness in there. All right, let's go. We can go. One of those vehicles is pulled out, so let's go in there and we can go and have a look at the other lioness. Just ease our way along here. What's so wonderful to see lion cubs again. I was really hoping to hear them calling, going, ow, wow, wow, wow. Which of course is why they are even cuter than leopard cubs. Although many would disagree. I don't know where the other lioness is. She's in here somewhere. You see her? No, that's her there. That's that big cat thing. That big cat thing on the ground there. Minzan. This is wonderful. So we have a lioness. Now, many of you, of course, have watched the Nkuhuma Pride for a long time. We've watched the Styx Pride, but we don't see the Styx very often. Now this, as far as I'm aware, is a Styx lioness. And I'd love to know if anybody has any disagreements on that. Do you all agree that this is a Styx lioness? I'm just looking with my binoculars. She's got quite a thick neck, I must say. Yeah, I don't recognize her as an Nkuhuma. See, her nose is kind of a... Well, it's mottled and it's got a nasty scar on the top of it. She's also got a bit of a beard, isn't she, Viam? Mm-hmm. A bearded lady.
Looks a bit like a wolf.
She does look a bit like a wolf. Anyway, nice to have a lioness that we can have a look at. And maybe, just maybe, she'll call those cubs back again. Hello, Marianne. Very nice observation from you, and you've answered your own question exactly correctly. You say those lion cubs look very relaxed around the vehicle. Do they take their cues from their mother? Yes, they do. They take all their cues from their mother, and as soon as their mother thinks about being nervous or running away, then those cubs will take their message from her.
Yeah,
you see the cubs?
Just a tail.
Where do you want to move?
No.
Liam can see a cub's tail.
See, left hand.
Oh,
top
yes,
corner.
yes. Well done. Brilliant spot. There, you can hear them calling. Or is that an alarm call? No, it's an alarm calling animal. It's just You still see them, don't you?
I had a glimpse of them.
Shall I go a little bit forward?
I can see the thing.
Not Lola. I'm just going to go past the front of them here. I'm just going to go past the front of you. Do excuse me. Thank you so much. Good morning. We'll just stop here and have a look. Any luck there, Vian? How are you doing? Have you got a view there? Can you see them? Backwards. I've got them there. Yeah, got them. Can you see? There, you can hear them calling. You can hear them calling. Look. And it's precisely that noise that I think gives them their incredible appeal. Thank you to all of you for confirming that that is a Styx lioness coming this way. This is wonderful.
James.
How are you?
You recognize Jim?
I do. It has, yes, yes. Goodness gracious me. Somebody on the other vehicle, everyone from university I was with. Haven't seen her for 20 years. That was a vehicle going past. I think they missed the lines. Oh well, sorry for them. There are two lionesses behind us now. But let's just stick on those cubs there. This is just brilliant stuff. Isn't that amazing? They're coming back this way. I'll now get out my camera so that I may take some rank average blurred photographs. She's calling the other two behind us who are just kind of grooming. Now they're coming this way. Here come the cubs. Oh, they've turned round. Don't go away. Here comes the lioness, Vimpy. She's also lactating. Oh, this is fantastic. Gone up onto the top of the termite mound there. And the same lioness we were sitting watching is still lying there doing nothing. But you could see that at least two of these females are obviously lactating. And I thought when I saw the four cubs that they're from two different generations, or certainly two different litters. Coming down the termite mound. Can hear them calling. And then you can hear the mother calling as well. Hoo, hoo. Just brilliant. Haven't seen lion cubs for what? Since, well, from probably since this time last year. Last had the Styx pride cubs frolicking around Treehouse Dam. Oh, coming down the mound again. Can you see the mound, Vim? Mm. Shall I go a little forward?
I no longer have a visual on that.
Let me sneak forward. But I think that might be it, I'm afraid.
Yeah.
Yeah, let's look at the lioness. She also looks like she's lactating, you know. She's definitely lactating. Going to take a photograph of him. Do you know why?
Because you're going to blur it?
Well, other than the fact that it'll be blurry, is that Lex Hess is watching us, of course. And Lex Hess doesn't have his camera out. There's obviously not a photograph worth taking.
You don't want Lex Hess to see your camera.
No, exactly. That's also true. James, Richard, you want to know if this is enough lioness action for VM. VM, was this sufficient action, or did you want some kind of mayhem and death to ensue?
No, just whip pan.
Just whip panning. Yeah. Okay, he likes to whip pan. What that means, everyone, is swing the camera from side to side because the action is so incredible that you don't know where to look. That is actually worth it. Would have been worth a picture. There she goes. That's a wood pan to me, everyone. Just move back. Oh, she's coming just behind us. She goes, and you can see the scars of a long life there, all over the shoulders and all over the skin, and that's just from boxing and fighting and living the life of a lion. And that, everybody, is going to be our first lion sighting for the day, perhaps not our only one, but not a bad one. That's it, I'm afraid. Fantastic stuff. Did you like that whip pan? Very nice whip pan. Really, working with VM is like working with a comedian full time. All right, let's move on from here. We're not too far from where I hoped Karula might come onto the reserve. Lex has been around here all morning, though, so I'm not sure if there are any tracks. We'll get an update from him, and then we'll see if we can find some tracks of the Great Queen. While we do that, let's head across to Byron, who has nothing.
Yes, James, you are correct. We still have nothing. I'm sure James is enjoying that this morning, that we have found very little and he seems to be finding everything for you. But it's good. I'll tell you why it's good. It's because just shows you this is not a zoo. We never know what we're going to find or how we're going to find it. We've got to really rely on our skill and our experience and a little bit of luck to find animals. And it just shows you, also, I think what it does too is that it allows us to appreciate those sightings so much more when we do see them. It's good to have mornings like this where it's very quiet, you don't see much wildlife. We did see some kudu earlier. A male and a female, but they moved off very quickly away from us. But I'm so happy that you've been able to see those cubs and those lionesses. That is very, very fortunate. We had the debate the other day with James and Brian about which cubs are cuter, lion or leopard. I'm not too sure what you think back home, if you think lion or leopard cubs are cuter. Personally, I think leopard cubs are cuter than lion cubs. Brian, you prefer lion, is that right?
Yeah, but on the fence, they're both quite incredible.
I think anything small in the bush is cute. All right, Brian, let's keep our eyes peeled. I've got a good feeling. I've got a good feeling. Let's stay positive. So, Kennedy has asked if I've ever touched a lion or a wild animal before. Kennedy, in the past, I've been involved in some research for certain animals. I've touched a cheetah that has been darted that was actually injured, unfortunately, that they the vets came through and helped, and it survived afterwards. It healed very quickly. So I touched a cheetah. I haven't touched a lion or anything. And I've also touched a rhino that they were being relocated into another area for research and conservation and that, of course. Rhino, very, very strong, thick hide. But the cheetah had very, very rough, rough hair. Very, very rough, very coarse. You wouldn't think so. You would think it would be soft and very slight. I've heard, though, the only big cat that has got soft hair is a leopard. The lion and the cheetah both have very coarse, rough hair. Generally, I prefer just viewing the animals and not touching them at all. I'm not a big fan of places where you can go and pet cubs and little animals, wild animals, because I think for education it's good, and people do learn a lot from it. But I often wonder what happens to those young animals once they get older and they no longer are able to be pet. Let's see what we have in this drainage line. Scan carefully. We're going to cut back up here. Back. Brian and I were just saying it's been such a cool or cold morning, not cool. But warmer. That could change our luck. Some beautiful big trees around here. I'm hoping that in the next few days I can find a leopard lying in a tree. So Dina would like to know what the best time for seeing birds is. So Dina, generally in the mornings, like now, birding is fantastic. There's a lot of bird calls and a lot of bird activity. So early mornings is really, really great for birding. And also in the afternoons. During the course of the day, it becomes a little bit harder to see birds. Or certain birds, I think you get less activity when it starts warming up. But generally, I found these early mornings are really good for birding. Let's see what birds we can spot. If I have anything sitting out in the open, try to find a few for you. Really lucky yesterday with our raptors. We saw Battalia eagle and we saw, oh, hang on. Yes, our first animal. Look what I've spotted off to the left. Oh, come on. Two little steenbok. A male and a female. Oh, that's wonderful. These small antelope are monogamous. They stay together and they usually mate for life. So that will be a pair, and they will stay in the same area. They are quite territorial. They'll have little middens, so dung patches, which they use to mark their territories, and they will stay in that area together. They're not always seen right next to each other, so we're really lucky to see the male and female close to one another. What occasionally happens is you may get a male 30 or 40 meters in one direction and a female in the opposite direction, but then they will meet up quite regularly, but they stay within that area together. Fantastic, lovely to see a small antelope like that. That is the smallest antelope we have in this area, and that is full grown. Can you believe it? That tiny, tiny antelope. Another small antelope we do find around this greater Kruger is the duiker, which I'm sure you have seen. They're also very, very shy, and you often get fleeting glimpses of these duiker bounding through the bush. Now, the word duiker actually comes from an Afrikaans or Dutch word, which means diver. And I think it comes from the way they run through the bush. They dive, almost it looks like they are diving through the bush. Very distinct running pattern. And then the Steenbok, the other one, and then another one called a clip springer, which directly translated means rock jumper. Also very small antelope, but incredibly agile, and often lives up on rocky outcrops. They jump around, they've got very pointed hooves, and they're able to jump and move across these rocks incredibly. Often you do see Inyala in small groups, not large herds like the Impala, but you may get a handful together, especially with the females. You'll get 3, 4, up to 10 or so females in a group. And the reason this female is alone is because I think she has come to give birth. So she's been hiding in a thicket. She's given birth, and now she wants to make sure that that lamb just gets a bit of energy and gets moving before she meets up with the rest of the group again, I'm sure. It's amazing how these young animals are able to get up, stand, and move minutes after birth. But of course they have to, because if they don't, they could fall prey to predators. So from lion cubs to an Inyala lamb. I can hear some branches breaking behind us. I think there may be some elephant heading towards us. But this is just so special. This is really something that you don't see often. Look at that. So cute. Almost looks like it's looking around, learning, trying to see what this world is that it's just been brought into. Look how unsteady it still is on its legs. Oh. And they're just moving deeper into the thicket. Wonderful. I think, why don't we give this mother a bit of space now? Let her look after that little lamb, and let's see what else we can find close by. Don't want to disturb them too much. That is very special. While I see if I can find these elephants that I can hear in this area, let's cross over to James and see if he has an update for us.
We thought about going to Arethusa, everybody, but then we just thought we'd come to Ledwood Road, which is on the far eastern sector of Juma. And the reason for that was that Lex has found no tracks of that leopard from yesterday. We don't know where she's gone. This is the one road that I didn't check yesterday. But I suspect she's gone back south, and that her tracks have been covered up by the lots of traffic that goes up and down that Gowrie main road that we were on with the lions earlier. So I haven't found any further tracks of her. We might be lucky a little bit later. Let's see what happens. But I'm sure there'll be something interesting to look at, and so very, very special to see little lion cubs again. I'm very distressed that they chose to spend 5 minutes on Juma and then went south again. Anyway, at least we got to see them. And soon, those Nkuhumas will have cubs and we'll have that joy daily. Hello, Debbie. You say I mentioned two different sizes of cubs. Am I thinking two different litters? Definitely. There are definitely more than one litter there, because there are at least two of the, both the females we saw walking across the road are lactating. So absolutely, there's more than one litter, and there might even be more than that. And one of the others might be about to give birth, and therefore she may well have started lactating already. So I think there are at least two litters there, and certainly there were two different sizes. But they will cross-suckle each other's cubs, and that's one of the great unique things about lions. Hello, Wendy. Nice one from you. Now, I mean, let's just frame your question quickly. You say, will those cubs sleep out in the open at night, or will they still have a den? They won't have a den, but she may well stash them in some thick bush, especially if she goes hunting. So they won't just sleep out in the open. If they're with mum and they're moving with mum, like I'm sure they have been since the early hours of this morning, you know, when it was still dark, then they will be in the open. When she lies down, they will lie down with her in the open. When she goes off hunting, or when the rest of the pride goes off hunting, as they must, she'll stash them in some thick bush. She'll go to an area that it's some kind of almost completely sixth sensory way of communicating. So she might growl at them slightly, and they'll go into some thick bush and they'll just lie there, and then they won't move until mum comes back, until they get a bit bigger. And when they're a couple of months old, well, let's say 4 or 5 or 6 months old, they'll move around then and sort of be naughty and play when they should be inside the cover. Well, just like kids of, you know, human beings will do. Let's check down there. I know Lex is trying that road. Let's see if he can pick up some tracks. All righty, we're going to go a little bit further to the north and then head down through the centre, down to the valley of the Great Mulwati. And if we find no further sign of the Great Queen, then I think we'll probably head across to see what's happening at Aratuza. So we've done a good drive around this reserve so far today. Might also head to the north. Anyway, doesn't seem to be a great proliferation of general game around here. We did see one steenbok running off. I think Byron found a steenbok, which is very nice, and a nyala, which is also very nice. But otherwise, he's had a day like I had yesterday. Very nice question from Zoe in Southeast Queensland, Australia. Zoe, my commiserations on your national rugby team's whitewash at the hands of the English yesterday. Sorry about that. Certainly would be a national tragedy if that happened here. You're probably not vaguely interested in rugby. That's all right. You ask a very astute question. And let's just quickly, there's an impala there. So while I talk about your astute question, I'll talk about one of the beneficiaries about what you're talking about. So you say, if all of the reserves in the area were to close down their water points and have one water point per reserve, would that affect the environment generally, and would it bring back the sable? Now, for those of you, just a quick background. Impala, like you're looking at now, and zebra, which we certainly have seen many of in recent times, they thrive in an area where there's lots of water, and all the landowners of this area pump a lot of water, and so it's really been very conducive to the survival of animals like impala and zebra, and not to animals like eland and sable, which are magnificent antelope, but they can't live in areas where there's too much water. They're not very effective grazing competitors, and they're good at moving to and from water, and their babies also have to hide in very long grass, which doesn't occur when you put lots of water around. That's in broad strokes. Now, Joey, were all the landowners to close down some of their water holes and just have one each? I mean, it really does depend on the size of the land. But let's say all the landowners of the Sabi Sands got together. There's 60,000 hectares here, which is about 140,000 acres or so. 140,000 acres, let's say we divided it into 10 and we put one water hole every 140 hectares, as opposed to it being probably 10 times that density now. Would that make a difference? Over the course of a long time, yes, I think it would make a difference. But it would probably need to go even further than that. Traditionally in this area, water would have been found on the perennial Sand River and on the Sabi River to the south. So if you're going to pump water at all, it should be in those areas, because areas like we're in now would have had no standing water at any stage. And that would have meant that if you wanted to go and view predators, you would have probably had to move closer to the rivers, and the predator densities at the rivers would be that much higher and would be that much better for viewing. Now, if you split the landscape up into little pockets like we have here, I meant to go down that road. You strip it up into these little pockets, then what you have is a situation where if you do something like that, if you close all the water holes on the little pockets of land, then you're not going to see some of the animals on these little pieces like we're on now. And so it's not ever going to happen, Zoe, I don't think. Over the course of, say, 20 years, if they left it for 20 years like that and they only pumped water on the Sand River and they left these areas completely free, yes, then I think the things like the sable would definitely come back. I just cannot see it ever happening, Joey. I don't believe it would. I think there's much too much invested in ecotourism. And ecotourism, of course, is a very fine balance. Ecotourism pays for this conservation land. Without ecotourism, then we just wouldn't have this land as conservation land. It would be used for something else, which would be very sad indeed. Viam, where are the animals? Viam, is that your world premiere singing? That's very nice. Did you like that, everybody? Too soft, he said. Let me repeat what he said. He said, "The animals are nowhere today." That is amazing. That is absolutely astounding. Anyway, we can very slowly make our way down this road. There are plenty of hyena tracks all over the place. I tell you what, if we don't find something soon, I might go across to the hyena den, or certainly suggest that Byron does. I don't think he's too far from this area. Hello, Alice. I'm not sure I've spoken to you, Alice. Very nice to have you with us. You say, what is the radius of our traversing area? Well, difficult to say because it's not really a circle, but it is. So, I mean, our traversing area is 6,500 acres, or hectares, it is 1,200 plus 800 is 2,000, plus about 2,500 hectares of land. So 2,500 hectares, 25 square kilometers. So I mean, that's the best way I can give it to you. The radius would be a bit difficult to work out, given that it's really not circular at all. 25 square kilometers, you can convert that to miles by dividing by 1.6. Well, it says it's about 15 square miles. It does keep my mind moving, comparing the metric system to the imperial. Shamsung, you want to know how many kilometers we drive in a drive? It really depends on what we see. If we go to Cheetah Plains and drive the whole of Cheetah Plains and then come back and do a bit on Juma, we can drive up to 25 kilometers, maybe 30 kilometers in one drive. And if we are, say we drive out of camp and we find lions on a buffalo kill on quarantine clearings, we'll struggle to get more than a mile or two. So it really depends on what we see. You know that you've had a a fairly animal-free drive when you've driven 35 kilometres normally, because it just means you're moving the whole time, looking. Corey, what a lovely question in from Calgary. You say, is it frustrating to come out and find nothing, or do you just take it in your stride? If I was driving around on my own, seeing animals would be purely a bonus, so it would be just the joy of being out in nature like this. You do start to feel a certain amount of pressure, and maybe pressure is the wrong word, but you start to feel a certain sense that you need to start showing people things, and so if you don't see any animals, it can become a little frustrating, especially if you plan to go out and hope to show people, say, Karula's cubs, and you don't even find a track, or you find tracks and you track for 2 hours and you don't find them. If you are not very careful, that can get to you. But yes, absolutely, you have to go into this with the attitude that nature will give you what nature's going to give you. We might be lucky, and some you take the good with the bad. There's a bushbuck. Such is our luck today. Corey, we found your bushbuck. Say when you got him, Jim. Has he run? She ran away. Jim, that's not very good. Why did you frighten her? Let's go out to our window. There's one eating outside our window in camp. Vim and I are neighbours, of course. We live on the salubrious side of the camp.
It's called the Starling Golf Estate.
Yes, it's known as the Golf Estate. This is because I have a golf net outside my window. All right. Well, we try not to get frustrated by the lack of animals out here. Let's head across to Byron and find out how he's doing on that score.
See, James, you just have to have patience in the bush. Don't get frustrated. Look what we just saw. We had a quiet morning, and then we had that Inyala with that beautiful lamb. And just before we spotted that, I was answering a question from Bruce. Bruce asked, why haven't we seen any springbuck on Safari Live? So Bruce, the reason is we don't get springbuck in this area. The springbuck occur in a part of southern Africa that is generally semi-arid or dry, very dry, desert-like habitat. They prefer the dry conditions. So kind of the central, southern and central part of South Africa, and also further north and west, the northwestern part of South Africa. Up here in the northeastern part, we don't get any springbucks, so that's why you haven't seen any. A friend of mine who used to work at Juma Game Reserve for many years gave me some advice the other day. He said, when all else fails, drive Sandy Patch and you should find a leopard. We are on Sandy Patch now. I'm trying to see if he is right. Turn into a beautiful morning. The sun is up now, it's really warm. I think the gloves are going to come off soon. Everything's starting to warm up. This is the time of the morning that I always say is quite dangerous. I say it's dangerous because as you start warming up, you start feeling so relaxed and so comfortable. Such a wonderful feeling. You often find yourself dozing off. So I've got to keep my wits about me and make sure I don't fall asleep. Brian will just tap me every now and then, make sure. I might have to tap Brian. Brian, you still with us?
Hold on.
So Lucy from South Bend, Indiana would like to know, have I ever lost a guest? Lucy, fortunately, no, I have not lost a guest. No, luckily not. I try and drive very carefully through the bush. The roads are quite bumpy. But before we do game drives with guests, we always give them a very, very in-depth briefing about what to expect, what to do, and game drive etiquette while we are driving around. You know, we are in an area where there are wild animals. We do have to be careful, we do have to be respectful. And while we're driving around with the bumpy roads and that, always remain seated on the vehicles so that you don't have a situation where you lose your balance and can fall off. So all of those rules are set in place for a reason, and to make sure that none of our guests get injured or hurt while they're on safari with us. But luckily, touch wood, no incidents yet, and I have not lost a guest. Beautiful area, that's nice and open. A lot of gwari trees, magic gwari trees around here. A lot of this evergreen tree that you can see in front of us, these are all gwari trees. Justin has asked, can safari guests bring food with on the drive while we are doing a game drive? Yes, definitely, of course you can. And what we do most of the time, especially at the lodges when we have got guests coming through, we always take a morning and an afternoon, not quite a picnic, but morning and afternoon snacks with us. So we'll have some drinks on the vehicle with us, especially in the mornings, some nice tea and coffee. And we bring some little biscuits or rusks, something that you can dip in the coffee and eat. So we bring snacks with us too, but guests are more than welcome to also bring something from the lodge if they would like to. They can have it while we are on drive, maybe a banana or an apple. But we never throw anything out of the vehicle while we're driving and just put it back in the vehicle with the peels or the apple core, and we throw it out when we get back to the camp. It's always nice to have something to nibble on while you're on safari, because you can be out here for 3 or 4 hours at a time. It all depends. So again, I'm getting to know this area quite a bit now and getting the hang of it and more or less which area I'm in. At the moment, I have no idea where I am, which is quite nice. All I know is I'm still on Juma. I'm trying to scan very carefully while I'm driving. Shamsun has just made an interesting comment. And as I said, I'm trying to scan very carefully. And Shamsun said, it must be very easy to miss a leopard lying out under a bush or under a tree. And yes, it is very easy. You know, if I often find, and or what I think, these animals only let us view them when they want to be seen. If a leopard or a lion or anything doesn't want to be seen, you're not going to see it. Their camouflage and their ability to blend in and disappear, incredible. So it's very easy to miss a leopard or anything for that matter that could be potentially hiding in a thicket. So we've got to be very aware and careful of what you're looking for. Try and scan the area properly. What does that? Thought I caught a glimpse of a track over here. No, I think it was a hyena track crossing the road. Okay, while I work out where I am exactly and where I'd like to go, cross over to James, get an update, and hopefully he's in a better mood.
I don't think I've been in a bad mood today. I'm going to beat Byron to within an inch of his life when I get home. Now, we've come towards Treehouse Dam, hoping to find some form of animal life. Since I last saw you, we have seen no form of animal life. I have heard the call of the black-headed oriole, But no animals at the moment. So let's pop onto the dam wall, see if we can find something there. If not, I'm sure I can find a tree to tell you about, because they don't run away. Or Karula.
A false Marula.
A false Marula. Kennedy, also I think possibly a new viewer, wonderful to hear from you. You say, how many endangered animals do we have in the bush? Kennedy, the two most obvious endangered species that we see out here are the cheetah and the wild dog. I'm just going to stop over here. Here we are at Treehouse Dam, which Viam insisted to come to. Well, Viam, I'm glad we came here. What a great idea you had. There's lots going on here. So, Kennedy, cheetah and wild dog, the most obvious examples of endangered animals out here. But we also have many a few endangered birds, the most obvious one of those being the ground hornbill, a big black turkey-like bird with a sort of red wattles, a red throat. And I've no doubt that there are any number of endangered amphibians and endangered invertebrates that we don't even know about. But cheetah and wild dog, the most obvious. Black rhino sometimes. I just want to go and check if there's any water in that hole over there. Vian, will you tell me if you lose my sound?
Cool. Should be fine. We're quite high up.
We are quite high up. I will keep the receiver high. Here is my receiver. Here we go, everybody. If I fall down here, know that I did it, sacrificing myself for your viewing pleasure. And Vian, if you could avoid filming my legs, that would be great. How's my sound? Good. Now, this fairly substantial hole in which I am standing now will hopefully fill up with water come the much expected diluvian floods that should descend on the area circa October today, at least October this year. But in the meantime, there is water flowing under the surface in theory. Not there. You're still hearing me, Vian? All of these patches have now dried up, everyone. There's no water in them. You can just see a little bit of moisture seeping to the surface, but there's no water. Just going to check one more. Can you still hear me, Vian? This is the last one, everybody. That's the last piece there, where there may have been some water. There's just some sort of moist sand in it. And I know the monkeys were coming down, and certainly the duiker and the impala were using it every so often, and certainly the warthog. But maybe the elephants haven't been through here for a while, and maybe because they haven't redug those holes. And so maybe they have to come through again, because I think they're probably the only ones capable of A, finding the flow under the surface, and then digging the holes for the water. That's quite interesting. So the water is still flowing underneath here, but it's obviously just getting very deep. Right, Biam, are you ready? Here I come. Aging bones. Hedrin muscles. There we go. I made it, Vian. Oh, you're so amazed.
I am at your athletic ability.
That is a... that's a crested barbet calling. The only form of life here at Treehouse Dam. This is amazing. Okay. On we go. It's a very, very beautiful day. Starting to warm up a little bit now. not too cold. I can keep my gloves off without my hands freezing completely. All right, let's go back across to Byron, get an update from him. Hopefully he has managed to not drive into anything and break his car.
I have not driven into anything, but look what we have here. A beautiful Dacia, which I was speaking about earlier. The other small antelope we get in this area. Remember I mentioned these are usually quite shy. They run off very quickly. This one seems to be very relaxed. It's a young male. Actually an old male. Sorry, you can see that horn, that right horn, it's actually broken off already. It can often happen. Maybe a little fight with another little Dacia trying to fight for territory. But look at him. Very elegant, dainty little antelope. And this is the one which bounds through the bush when it does run off. I'm so glad he's standing. Often they run off very quickly. They're very shy little antelope. And I think one of the reasons for that is because they are so small and solitary a lot of the time. You might find them in pairs too, but generally you see them alone. They've got to be very careful. There's no one else to keep a lookout and warn them if there's any potential danger. So what they prefer to do is rather just run away and get out of sight of whatever might be in the area. Let's just see, it's disappeared through the thicket there now. There he goes. So a question from I Walk in the Rain. That must be a Twitter handle. So I've asked, do the small antelope have a rutting season? No, they don't. These antelope don't. They may have seasonal mating times, but they do not have a rutting season like the impala and wildebeest, who have very distinct rutting seasons in this part of South Africa. These little antelope can potentially mate any time of the year. And there it goes. Off it goes. Lovely. I'm glad we saw it. So no distinct rutting season for these smaller antelope. But some of the other antelope, the large antelope that we have spoken about, they do. And also if you look at that Inyala, for example, that we saw, for a youngster to be born in the middle of winter, that's unusual. It just shows they don't have a distinct rutting season or mating season either. They can mate any time of the year. Ooh. Kudu, kudu, kudu. Good morning. Look at this beautiful female kudu. Another few running through here. Raina from Texas would like to know, are there any dik-dik in this area which we are in? No, there are not, Raina. We do not have dik-dik down here. That is another small antelope. Looks almost similar to that Dacia that we just saw. There are dik-dik in the northwestern part of Southern Africa. So in Namibia, we do not have dik-dik in South Africa, but the only Southern African dik-dik is found up in Namibia, so not in this area at all. Or, Brian, I wonder if we can get a bird that is flying above us. A little bit tricky. It's a lilac-breasted roller, straight up. Oh, and there it's doing his display. It's difficult. Has gone down. Very difficult. Yeah, and that was a lilac-breasted roller, and they get the name roller from a beautiful display that they do. They'll call and make a loud noise while they're flying up, and then often what they do is they stop flapping their wings, and they do a few rolls or loops down and up, and as they go down again, they literally rock from side to side. They look like a fighter jet. They go and they do this all the way down. That's how they get the name Roller. This kudu have just moved off behind us. Nice to see them. Look like a small family group. Look like an adult female with two younger kudu. Different ages, obviously, but that were all moving together. Similar to the Nyala, you can find kudu in small groups like that. Not large herds, really, like the Impala or Springbuck in other parts of South Africa. Oh, there's some parrots flying past us. Let me see if they perch. Nope, they've flown off. Brown-headed parrots. It's wonderful. I'm not sure if you can often pick up on the sounds that we're hearing, and it's quite difficult at times. But every now and then we get to hear these birds flying past, and a lot of the bird species have very distinct calls. And those parrots, a very, very typical parrot call. They're chirping, high-pitched chirping, and they just flew past. A lilac-breasted roller just took off from a tree above us. Oh, it's nice and warm now. Well, much warmer than it was this morning. So I think the gloves can come off. Gloves are off. So James Richard would like to know what some of my favorite trees are. So James Richard, one of them is definitely the leadwood tree. It's a beautiful, beautiful tree. And we touched on it the other day. I spoke about it. Very, very strong, sturdy tree. They end up standing or growing for many, many years. And even after they die, they end up standing for between 50 to 80 years. Very, very strong tree. Another one of my favorite trees is this tree right next to us. And it is called a marula tree. Have a look at that. Very, very beautiful marula. One of the reasons I like a marula is because it's got these very thick branches that branch out from the stem, from the main stem. And I always think to myself, these make perfect leopard trees. And I have been fortunate. I have seen leopards lying and draped over these branches in different areas. The other animal that loves them, the elephant. The elephant feed on the marula fruit in summer. They've got a very, very tasty fruit, rich in vitamin C. We can eat them, and it's got a lovely flavor. And have a look there. Brian is focusing on a sign that elephant have actually been interested in this tree. What has happened there is an elephant has pushed its tusk in through the side of the tree, and they do that to try and feed on the bark. Luckily, it didn't strip the bark off right around the tree, because if it does that, it is known as ring barking, and the tree inevitably dies. The reason for that is the bark transports all the nutrients from the leaves to the tree and from the roots to the tree. When that bark is stripped off, that the layer which transports all those nutrients is stripped away, and it's unable to do that, and the tree will then die. But luckily, this tree was not badly damaged, and it will continue to grow. Definitely one of my favorite trees, with the leadwood. It's been a great morning, even though we haven't seen too much wildlife. We've seen some of the smaller things, like the young Inyala. We saw some kudu, saw the dacre. And it's always great to stop and speak about all the other stuff around, not just the animals. Speaking about trees, here's another one, which I'm sure has been spoken about before, but it is a beautiful tree, and it's called an apple leaf. Let me show you quickly. There we go. Just off to our right. This is a beautiful apple leaf tree. And in some cultures in Africa, in Southern Africa especially, they refer to this as the rain tree. And the reason for that is
there are little bugs which occur on the leaves of these trees, known as spittle bugs. The spittle bugs suck the moisture out of the leaves, and what happens is it passes through their body very quickly, and liquid is then excreted from these bugs. And occasionally you would hear stories of locals going and lying under these trees for shade, and then it felt like it was raining. They'd get these little drops of liquid on them, and that is from the spittle bugs. So that's where the name rain tree comes from. This is the apple leaf. Very, very beautiful tree. Now, the name apple leaf comes from a story which I don't know if I agree with completely, but apparently, and I've tried it a number of times, James and I have both tried it, and we've, especially when I was training many years ago, we tried to see if we could understand this theory. They say if you take the leaves and you break them in half, it sounds like that sound when you bite into an apple, that crunch. That's where this tree gets its name, apple leaf, from. We broke a number of leaves and we can't quite hear the resemblance, but you never know. So we are going to continue searching for some wildlife now. Enough about trees, I think. And while I do that, let's cross over to James and get an update from him.
Hello, everybody. We are heading north in Arusa because apparently there are three. What?
Speaking.
Speaking. Kirsten, what did you mean when you said speaking? Oh, she said hold off speaking. Right, we're okay now. Have to give her a severe beating when we get home as well. No coffee for Kirsten. Now, three lionesses at Red Dam. So we're heading up there. We shouldn't be too long before we're there. So that'll be quite nice. Not sure who they are. It's all rather confusing how many lions there are knocking about the place at the moment, but they're most likely the Nkuhuma pride. Now, I believe you were chatting to Byron about his most favorite trees. Viam, you gave a list of your favorite trees. Topping the list, the false marula.
Yes,
false marula. That's a fairly unimpressive tree. What else did we have?
Nkuhuma tree,
a brown ivory, yes, or certainly on my top five. Jackalberry, you said?
Yeah.
Yes? Oh, and a flat-topped acacia?
No, I just said I want one.
Oh, you want one. But they don't, they're not... Oh, right. Let's continue that discussion once we've had a look at some pigs with Byron.
Thank you, James. We do have some pigs. We have warthog. Just as I said, we're going to go look for some more animals. They popped out. This looks like a family. There's a big male in the middle. There was a female leading in the front, but that's the big male. Look at him. Beautiful. Look at those tusks. And those warts on the face, you can see clearly. And that's how they get the name warthog. And then four piglets following them. Look at that. That one's on its knees feeding. That's typical warthog behavior. They go down on their front knees and they use that snout to dig up roots and shoots of grass, which they love to feed on. They love to feed on specific plant material, grass. So they've got a very unique way of feeding. They go down, drop onto their knees. The male seems to be chasing the female off. They've just moved a little bit. Perhaps he is looking to mate. So this is what we call a sounder of warthog. That is what a group of warthog are known as, a sounder. Have a look at that very clear, can you see those very clear white hairs on the side of the face of those young warthog? Now the reason for that is it is meant to resemble the large tusks of the adults. So that if a predator sees these young warthog, it possibly thinks twice about hunting them, because it may see that white hair and think perhaps
that those are sharp tusks like the adult has. So they've adapted this as a way to deter predators from hunting them. Very interesting. You can see it clearly there. Look at that. It does almost look like those tusks of that big male that we saw. And off they go. Wonderful. That was great. There we go. So from the warthog, James has got some dwarf mongoose.
There you are, people. As Byron said, he didn't tell you an untruth. There are some dwarf mongoose. And they've just come out of their little mound, which is in the middle of the road. It is a house. It's a very silly place to put a house, of course, in the middle of the road. But they're very sweet. Vim, did you just take a picture of me taking a picture?
No.
You better not have. I've taken many blurred photographs of these dwarf mongoose, everyone. There's another one. Still, what they're doing now, of course, is they're coming out and they're doing precisely what Vim and I are doing, in that they are stopping, and at least not, yes, stopping. We've stopped. See, in order to be in the sun, in the still air. So they've come out and they're not running around. They're just sort of enjoying warming in the sun slightly. And it's very warm when you're not moving. But the air is still pretty chilly all around outside. And dwarf mongoose and other little animals like this, of course, can't really afford to get very cold. So they spend a lot of time warming up in the sun in the mornings. Now, they're under the ground. They're in a little termite mound from a group of termites called the Odontotermes. And they don't make very big mounds. They just make those sort of shallow ones like you're looking at there. But they're still very, very well insulated inside. And that's why they make an ideal home for something like a dwarf mongoose. Even though I must say, you know, they are a certain, something of a risk, those holes, because you can get very cornered very easily inside one of them, or inside a termite mound like that. And so it's fertile hunting ground for something like a mamba. A black mamba would have a great time going into a mound like that and trying to devour a couple of little baby dwarf mongoose. And I think they'd probably do that. And that's probably their greatest risk, living in a termite mound on the ground like that. Stop it, Vim. Film the animals. Vim finds my efforts at photography most amusing, don't you, Vim? He says. I do try hard.
Well, there's full of people that try hard, Ken.
I know. That is blurred. Absolutely hopeless. Being hopeless. Anyway, let's go and see. I think we should go and see the Nkuhuma lionesses. What do you think, Vim?
Yes.
Are you still incessantly... There we go. Right. Nevin, we're going to carry on. Nevin, you're in North Australia. That's really nice to hear from you there. It's one of the places in the world I would really like to visit one day. Nevin, you say, well, we'll just watch the mongoose. I think they're probably going to go inside, back into their little den. Nevin, you say, have I ever been asked a question by a viewer or a guest and given an answer, sort of made up an answer? I probably stretched the truth once or twice, especially as a young guide, but the very first lesson you learn as a guide, or certainly in the guiding school that I went to, was that you don't ever busk. If you don't know the answer to something, you say, I don't know, I'll find out and I'll get back to you. And that was a very valuable lesson. And certainly in South Africa, and I don't know, I think it's probably the same in many places where there's a kind of macho culture amongst the men, to find a South African man who will say to you, I don't know, is rarer than finding wild dogs killing elephants on a daily basis. We are programmed for some reason into giving an answer to every question, regardless of whether we have any kind of idea what we're talking about at all. And I mean, I think this is probably the same throughout the world, but I've only kind of seen it here. And so to learn to say, I don't know, in front of somebody who is clearly expecting you to know, was a very important lesson that I learned. And it's because people are not idiots. Well, I mean, of course, there are many idiots in the world, but generally people who take the time to watch a show like this, for example, or people who have taken the time to travel to a place like this, well, they're not idiots. They know what's going on in the world. Otherwise, they wouldn't be here. And so you've got to be very careful about talking nonsense. And I know that there's certainly, I've seen it, and I've watched people, you know, busking away, talking utter nonsense, and get burnt very badly by people on the back of the vehicle saying, no, but hang on, in the book that I read before I came on holiday, because a lot of people will do that before they come to an area like this, they'll read extensively, and then they'll, you know, lay out a sheet of facts or something that the guy has just sort of, he's assumed that his guests know nothing. He's given them some outlandish yarn and been burnt very badly by a superiorly educated guest. And so one of the big things was to learn to say, I don't know, I'll find out and I'll get back to you. And there certainly have been an incredibly valuable lesson for what we do here, because here, instead of having six people who may or may not know what's going on in the back of the car, we've got thousands. And you can rest assured that if you make a mistake, someone's going to jump on you. And I think it's wonderful. I really think it's great. At the beginning, I felt a certain sense of pressure, but now I've eased into being able to say, I don't know, but I bet somebody out there who's watching does know. And 9 times out of 10, we get a great discussion going, or we get a good answer from somebody with insight or knowledge that the rest of us don't have. Now, we're just approaching the lions here, so let's drive very carefully. It should be just around the corner, the dam's here. I don't see any vehicles. Do you, VMP? What is VM's? Oh, there we go. You see the lion, Vim? Could you sound slightly more excited, please? I'm going to ask you again, can you see the lion?
A little bit.
Okay, that's not really working, but let's go forward. So there she is, one lioness, looks very fat, and apparently the Nkahumas. There's another one over there. Two that side, one this side. Look at the best position to get into. Let's look at this one first. Good morning, madam. Now, who is this, everybody? Can somebody please identify which Nkuhuma lioness this is? I'm so bad with faces. Okay, so that's our pink-nosed semi-sub-adult. So we know her. She has got very swollen nipples as well. So whether she's about to give birth or not, she certainly looks fat enough to be about to give birth, but that might just be a meal that she's had. And in the background, the birds that Byron showed you, the brown-headed parrot. All right, so Sid, you're interested in knowing an update of the general sort of lion update of the area. Well, Sid, the general lion update is at least 2 Nkuhuma lionesses of the 5 have got cubs. one on Torchwood, one we think somewhere on Juma, at least another one about to give birth. And so that's the status of play, and the other's possibly pregnant here at the Inguhuma Pride. So that's the state of play here. Then on the Styx Pride, three females there today, but they do tend to join up with some others to the further south of them. They have got at least four or five cubs as far as I'm aware, and we saw them today, and so that was great. The Birmingham boys, three of them on Biffle's Hook at the moment, and they were with three lionesses yesterday. Could well have been these three, but I don't think it was these three. So as yet sort of semi-unidentified lionesses. And then the Matimbas, our other males, they're headed off down south towards Londolozi. And the other Birmingham boy, there were tracks of him wandering about Juma today. I suspect he's gone north into Biffle's Hook to see if he can find his brothers. So that's a general lion update. And you can see these cats deeply fat at the moment, aren't they, Viam? Mm-hmm. Not moving around a great deal or with any kind of enthusiasm. Let's go and look at the others. They're over there. We'll just pop round the corner there. And, I mean, I could probably drive that close to her. I guess that's how we'll have to do it. So we're going to drive within 4 feet of this lioness, the world's most terrifying terrestrial predator. Well, maybe with the noticeable exception of the tiger. And because I'm not on foot, I think it's unlikely that she'll react. I'm still going to watch her very carefully and not take anything for granted. The quickest way to get yourself into trouble in the wilderness is to assume that everything is just A-OK all the time. There, madam. You don't think? You don't think she's pregnant? So she's probably just lactating. No, she's not lactating. She's just fat, maybe. All right, let's have a look at these two. Yeah, that's interesting, Viam. So she's got swollen nipples, but she's certainly not lactating, so she's not suckling. Right here. This is not a great position, is it? Let me go forward a bit. And then we'll try and identify the slot. Oh, one of them's leaving herself right where she lies. Stunning. Now, who is that? It's also got a pinkish nose.
Which one are you checking out?
This is the close one, yeah. This is the youngest one. And unsurprisingly to me, she doesn't look to be pregnant. And nor does this one, who's much older. An almost entirely black nose. And she doesn't have those swollen nipples. I think that big lioness behind us is pregnant. Anyway, time will tell. And they're very peacefully lying here, happily in the shade. Well, in the sun, actually. But I think Sunday has become a little bit overwhelming for them. And they're going to chill out now for many hours to come. As is the way with lions. Nice work if you can get it, don't you think, Viam?
Mm-hmm.
Yes. Joel, a very nice question from you. We've had some really good ones today. You're in New York and you say, does the drought affect the nutritional status of the lions because the prey that they eat obviously is affected by the drought? Joel? I don't think there's a sort of continuum. So if you think of a graph of I know graphs to most people will make them go to sleep, but if you think of a graph of nutritional content on the y-axis and time on the x-axis, you could basically draw a sort of parabola there. And so on your x-axis, if you, I'll try and draw this for you and show you what I mean just now. But basically, Joel, what it means is that the nutritional status of the cats will actually go up during a drought to start with, because the as the animals weaken, so they will be easier to catch, and so there will be more to eat. And then certainly, as you say, once the nutritional status of those prey animals drops below a certain level, then it will start to affect the prey animals, at least the predators. So for example, if the impala of this area start to become too denuded of nutrients, what will happen is that they will stop, they'll start to digest their own muscles, they'll start to digest their own bone marrow, and once they start to do that, of course, they become much less nutritious to actually eat. But before they do that, they'll get weakened and they'll be a lot easier to catch. And because the bush is a lot less dense, they'll be easier to catch. But there will be a point beyond which they will become less healthy to eat. I'll try and draw you my graph if you're interested once we've left this lion sighting. I don't think we're going to hang around here for too long, everyone. There's really very little going on at all. So we'll sit here for a little bit longer. Let's head across to Byron for an update, and then we'll decide what to do from there.
I'm so glad you got to see some more lions with James. It looks like he's having all the luck with the cats this morning. We are heading towards the hyena den. I'd like to see if there's any activity around here. We just got into the turn off from the main road to the den, I think. this does look right. Let's see if we're lucky and have any hyena around. So Roger from Florida has asked a question about the hyena population and if the hyena in this area have an effect on the lion population. So Roger, it's a very good question, and it's difficult to say, but I'm almost certain that the amount of a hyena definitely affect the amount of other predators in the area. Hyena are really quite high up on the predator hierarchy. They're just below lions. They're very powerful. They work together as a clan, often to scavenge or chase other predators away from a kill. So if there are far fewer lions in the area and the number of hyena is very high, it could influence the lion population and cause lions maybe to move out a little bit and try and find an area where there aren't as many hyena. The other thing is with leopard, if there's a lot of hyena around, leopard also don't like it very much because hyena will go and steal their kills very often. But in saying that, both lion and leopard have worked out a way to try and keep hyena at bay. Leopard will hoist their kills into trees so that hyena, hang on a second, let's just have a look. On the top, it looks like a hyena. Can you see it there, Brian? No, very tricky from this angle. Just try to reposition. Just in the top. You got it. There we go. Right on top of the termite mound. So as I was saying, the leopard, for example, hoist their kills into trees so that they can avoid hyena. So hyena aren't able to steal the food from them. They don't always do it, but they do it quite often. And lions, generally, if there are some dominant males in the area, they keep the hyena in check. The male lions can often kill hyena if they do get too close and do try and challenge them for their kills. So that will in turn keep the hyena population in check.
So it's give and take, but I think if there are a lot of hyena, they may influence the lion population slightly in terms of possibly chasing some lion out of an area. Don't see any sign of the young ones. Just trying to scan around and see if there aren't some others lying out. So Scott has asked a question about the mating of hyena and what level male or what rank male will impregnate the beta female, possibly not the alpha female or the queen or the matriarch. And that's a good question, Scott. I'm assuming it could very possibly be any one of the larger males that pass through an area can impregnate that female. Doesn't necessarily have to be a single dominant male that mates with the females. It can be another male. But also the thing is, you'll have different males coming into a clan to mate with the females. It won't necessarily be a male from that clan. Within a clan, there's a matriarch, and she has got, or she will have, a number of young and sisters and other related hyena within that clan. And there will be males within there, but you may get dominant males coming in from different areas to mate with hyena. And it's interesting, usually it's only the dominant female or the matriarch which will mate and give birth to cubs. But in larger clans, she will allow other females below her to mate and have cubs, and they will all raise them together within the clan. I think that hyena is lying up there because it's getting a lovely bit of sunlight, so warming up. As I mentioned, the animals feel cold just like we do. So to lie in the sun and warm up in the morning like this is really, really great. I'm sure there are others around. Some of the hyena were lying down in the drainage line behind us a few days ago. There may be an area which they enjoy lying out, relaxing. There could also be some other hyena on the other side of the termite mound that we just can't see right now. I still haven't seen the cubs in this den site. James, I know, had a little bit of luck the other day and got to see two or three little faces popping their heads out. They're still very, very young, completely black at that age. And then as they get older, those spots in that brown coloration starts to come out. After a few months, about 3 to 4 months, you start seeing the change very, very clearly. So nice and peaceful here at the moment. We're going to sit here for a few more minutes, just see if we don't have any hyenas popping their heads out. While we do that, head back to James and get an update on what those lions are up to.
James has found the last remaining flowers of the summer hanging out here in the drainage line. And they are plumbago flowers. They are white plumbago flowers. Let's put them in the sun here. Liam, you're being most inconvenient this morning. There they are. Very beautiful flowers. And they come in blue. They can come in pink. They come in purple too. Isn't that pretty? They smell of nothing at all. And they've got very sticky little seeds, I suppose you'd call them. So once the flower has been pollinated, the pollen goes down there into the middle of the flower, and then this little sticky bulb forms underneath, like this. And and then it sticks on the fur of animals as they go past. Like this.
Keep it still.
There. See? And then the animal walks along and deposits it when it deposits the flower or the seed when it walks past a scraping thing. Right, there we are. Good. Excellent. Well done, Liam. Good job. Let's carry on. We're in the valley of the great Marikeni drainage line here, driving along, having a little boat ride. Not really sure what we're hoping to see. We left those lions because they couldn't be bothered to get up and perform for us, which I suppose is fair enough. They do have a life hard enough without having to act for us. But they're fast, fast asleep. So I think we'll just leave them and carry on and see what else we can find on this very, very pleasant Sunday morning. We'll also try not to destroy the aerial as we go. Hyena's not out, I believe, just the one there. Hopefully those little cubs will stick their heads out. Ah, Roger, very nice. Want to know what temperature a mamba needs in order to become active. Roger, I'm going to use my very first guiding lesson here and say I don't know, but I'm going to try and work it out for you, and if anybody knows better, you're welcome to tell me. A mamba, of course, is a reptile. It is therefore cold-blooded, which means that its body temperature is dependent on the ambient temperature. Now, we all know that at roughly 36.5 to 37 degrees, our bodies function optimally. Above 40 degrees Celsius, I mean, you can work this out in Fahrenheit too, I think that's 102 degrees Fahrenheit. 98 is our body temperature Fahrenheit. I'm just going to do it in Celsius from now. It will become too confusing for my small brain. And above 40 degrees, any mammal, or above 40, 41, maybe 42 in some cases, the proteins in your body start to denature. So the enzymes, which are crucial to the functioning of your body, that do all sorts of, or facilitate all sorts of chemical processes in your body and allow you to survive, they'll start to break down and then you get into trouble. So there's that optimum band somewhere between 36 and 40 degrees where your enzymes function at their best. Now, for a reptile, that's not entirely dissimilar. I think they'll probably function a lot better at colder temperatures than ours do, but they still have to get to a certain temperature. So I'm going to say that the ambient, the body temperature of the reptile, like a black mamba, has probably got to go up to about 35 degrees in order for it to be able to effectively operate. I imagine it can probably operate when it's sitting at around 27 degrees or so. There's some impala running across the road. And the only way it can do that is to lie openly in the sun. And you know that your temperature will sort of, you'll start to sweat if you lie in the sun. Well, they don't start to sweat, they just get to the correct temperature and then they start to move around. So, Roger, I hope that kind of answers your question. Very nice question. All right, we have some impala here. Let us be thankful for small mercies. Stop and have a look. And it brings up another discussion that I often have with people. They say, well, we want to see the big five. And you say, are you sure you want to see the big five? You don't want to see impala and things like that. And they say, yes, well, we do, but we want to see the big five. So we go and we see lions like the ones we've just seen there, lying there in a puddle of their own urine. And they don't do anything, they just kind of lie there. And then you come to a sighting like this, of these magnificent impala, the most elegant antelope around here. And they're doing things, and they're feeding, and they're frolicking, and they're flicking flies off their bottoms with their tails. And they're behaving in really interesting ways. And I just think this is so much more entertaining than a flat cat. Beautiful, magnificent colours as well. Oh, the jumping. Great jumping skills they have. Not quite as good as the Nyala, but still pretty good. Yeah, I think I might take my scarf off, such as the temperature of the day. I have already made a noise because I know that my microphone is close to my scarf. and listening. And what they're going to do is they'll do a little bit more eating, I imagine. They've probably been much like those buffalo we saw earlier on, having a bit of a feed through the middle of the morning. Then they'll go and find some shade, and there they will chew the cud for a little while. But you can feel how still the morning is. Just a black-headed oriole calling. But everything else has kind of gone into that lull of the mid-morning, which is just so very pleasant. And some of these male impalas, some of the rams, are still knocking about herding females together, trying to keep them in some kind of a harem structure, which of course is a waste of time, because any female impala that's going to be pregnant is already pregnant. And so I guess it's just a kind of throw over to the rutting season when the testosterone levels are still pretty high. Ease our way past these fellows. Now, there were supposed to have been some leopard tracks around here yesterday. I haven't seen any, but there are thousands of hyenas that went running up and down the road here. We'll just ease our way past these very confiding impalas. And we'll go down towards the Arethusa Dam, I think, and then head back to Juma from there. A couple of elephant tracks around. But otherwise, not a great deal. I feel like I've just had something read to me in English that isn't in English. Kirsten, I've either gone mad or I'm not following the question. Can you go again with that? Ellen, you've asked a question. Sounds like a good one. Okay. Ellen, so you are interested in how it is that cats make their babies lie still and remain quiet when they're away. How do mother cats do that, and how do mother antelope do the same thing? Well, in the case of the cats, I think in the case of all of them, I think it's almost entirely instinctual. When mum's not around, you're afraid, and so you shut up and you just lie down in a bush. So a wonderful example would be something like a sable antelope or even a waterbuck, where they'll give birth, the youngster will lie in some thick grass. It'll frolic around when the herd is around, but then when mum needs to go off and have a drink, as soon as mum departs, they will lie down in the bush, and they're instinctually quiet. I believe it's completely instinctual. And the same thing happens with the cats. They'll frolic around when the mother lions are around. Then when they make that, I don't know exactly how they do it, but they'll make a growl or communicate on some other level, and the cubs will go into thick bush, and they'll be quiet, and they won't say a thing, and they won't move. And it's purely an instinctual thing. When mum's not around, you're quiet, and you're down, and you're not doing anything. And we had an interesting sort of sighting the other day of the two Karula cubs, George and Charlotte, and they were sitting without her. She'd gone off hunting, and George was up in a tree, and Charlotte was down on a termite mound, and they weren't doing anything. They just sat there, and we spotted them, and they came around. At least they didn't move until George knew he'd been spotted, because he could see us, and then he could see us looking at him. And he became a little bit uncomfortable, and so he came down out of the tree and hid. And she didn't think we'd seen her. She was sitting on the top of a termite mound basking in the sun. It was the most wonderful little sighting. And she just lay there in the sun enjoying herself, but she wouldn't go and play with her brother. And they wouldn't sort of play together and frolic about the place without the mother there. And that's purely an instinctual response to feeling unsafe without their mum there. So Ellen, I would say it's almost entirely instinctual. And what the specific sign is that a mother gives to her youngster, I don't know. There I go again, Viam, saying I don't know. Did you notice that?
I don't even know.
No. You've stopped listening to me, haven't you?
Yeah.
Viam has stopped listening, everybody. He's just driving along, enjoying his Sunday morning, enjoying the great blue skies above our heads. All right, let's go across to Byron, get an update from him. I'm going to head towards the water with a bit of speed.
We left that hyena den, just the one lying right on top. We didn't have any activity or couldn't pick up on any activity from others in the area. So we decided to move on. Brian and I are searching our hearts out for any activity. Understand there's some elephant at the Vuyatela waterhole, at the Juma waterhole. So we might try and head into that area, see if we can't get some elephant at the water and see how many there are. But you never know, it could bump into something along the way. Really nice and warm now, so I'm thinking that start getting a lot more activity from animals, moving around a lot more, maybe heading down towards water. You could still get predators moving around this time of the day, even though it is already 9 o'clock or so, and in summer most of the predators would be hunkered down in a thicket in some shade because the temperature is very hot already at this time of the morning in summer. But now in winter it's still really nice and cool, so you do still get a lot of movement from those types of animals. So Brandon in Ohio has asked what is the best sighting I've ever had as a guide in my career. Brandon, it's such a difficult question to answer. I've been very fortunate and I've seen a lot of different very exciting sightings, from leopards hunting and killing to lions hunting, wild dog hunting. Wild dog hunting, it's always very exciting because just the way they work together and how fast and trying to keep up and follow them, it's incredible. So those are really exciting. If I had to pick one, I don't think I would be able to. It's very difficult. Each are very different and each are exciting. But I have been fortunate that I've seen a lot in the years that I've been guiding. One sighting that I can think of, I remembered, it was exciting but very emotional at the same time. And the reason for that was a pack of wild dog were running through an area and they were on the hunt. And as they do, they'll often just move through a whole area. And if something gets flushed out or they find a herd of impala, for example, they'll split off and they'll run together into the area and try and hunt those impala. So in this particular morning, they were running through an area and they were crossing through some drainage lines. And as they ran down, they ran into a leopard, which was resting in the drainage line. And the leopard, I mean, they are so quick and agile. And as the wild dog ran through, the leopard got a fright, obviously, and quickly turned and managed to grab one of the wild dogs, one of the younger wild dogs, bit him and broke his back. And as that happened, the rest of the pack ran to help this wild dog, and the leopard was up in a tree in a flash. This poor wild dog was then lying down and was injured, couldn't move, broken back, so it was going to die anyway. But then what happened was a few hyena ran in, chased off the other wild dog, and they killed this wild dog and began to eat him. Just shows you how opportunistic they are. They obviously heard the commotion. They were in the area and they came straight through to get whatever food was around, and they did. So that was an incredible sighting, but very emotional. Very emotional, and it's very difficult to see at times. But that is nature and that is the way the bush is. While I head towards the waterhole, James has got some more warthog for you.
Well, the sort of a warthog, everybody, is just lurking behind the bushel there. I don't want to start the engine, give him a dreadful fright. Here he comes out. And I think he's a young boar. No, he's not. He's a young sow. She is the young sow. And I don't know why she's on her own. Now, the way I can tell that, of course, by the number of warts on her face. She's only got that one small set just under her eyes. On a male, those would be much bigger, and there'd be another set just behind her front tusks there. She's got quite impressive whiskers for a lady, don't you think, Viam? Mm-hmm. They're almost as impressive as your whiskers at the moment. Yes. Very long, luscious hair on the back of her back there.
I actually got a mane, not whiskers.
You do have a mane, not whiskers, yes. Yeah, she's the ramp model of the warthog world, that. Very nice, finely manicured whiskers there. Now, watch her use her snout there to eat. There's a very good reason, of course, that a pig has that hard snout in the front of its face. And the reason for that, of course, is that it's like a little spade. And she uses it to dig out the bits and pieces of roots that are underneath the ground there. She pulls up the rhizomes, which are the underground stems that contain a lot of carbohydrates and nutrients, where the plant stores those things for dormant times. And she digs them up with her snout, and that's why she sits there on her knees. Now, those little balls that you can see near her, that next to which she's eating, are wild aniseed or osimum, and I've never seen an animal eat them. I just want to see if she is actually eating those. They're very aromatic, so they're full of oil. No, she's just eating grass. Now, the other thing to ask, of course, is what on earth would the function of those whiskers be? Because, I mean, I can't really see what they'd be used for. Certainly in the youngsters, you will read that they're there because the teeth take a while to grow. And so, you know, in the youngsters, those whiskers look like tusks initially. And maybe it might sort of deter predators from trying to eat them, but I don't think it does. But that really is quite an impressive set that she's got. Look at her digging there with her snout. That's wonderful. All right, let's head across to Byron. Byron has also got something with quite a long snout. Much longer than this one, though.
These snouts or trunks are much longer than the warthogs, James. That's right. Look at this wonderful herd of elephant we got at the Juma waterhole. This is great. Always, always fantastic to see elephant, especially at water. I just love watching them, the way they interact and how they use those trunks to drink. And watch, a lot of them are sucking water up with their trunks and then blowing it back out. Often what they're wanting to do is just get some clean water, so they'll try and splash away some of the dirt or sand from the top of the water, and then they'll suck up the clean water and drink that. Look at that young one. Oh, if you look there, just over there, that adult just sprayed water on top of that youngster. He's not very happy. That is very interesting. I wonder why it did that. But it's I suppose, a younger elephant that sprayed the water, not quite an adult. And there's that baby now. Look at that. Probably just getting the hang of using its trunk. And it takes them
just over 2 years to fully learn how to use that trunk properly. And that youngster is probably a year and a half to 2 years old, maybe. Oh, that's wonderful. So peaceful here. And these elephants just seem to be enjoying standing in the sun, warming up. They've got water right here, just resting a little bit before they decide to move on and feed for the day. They most likely may go past some water again later this afternoon. Elephants do need to drink a lot of water, so they will occasionally go past water 2 or 3 times a day, especially when it is a lot drier. Look at that. Looks almost like that one is trying to scratch the top of its mouth. Do you see that? Possibly a few tusks that are coming through there. And, you know, you usually get these little tusks. From about 3-4 years, you start seeing these tusks pushing through. I think maybe it's getting a bit itchy for that little one and scratching the top of its mouth. That's where the tusks will come through. But you can see it's still learning, it's still exploring and working out how this trunk works. See, smelling, picking, trying to work out how it can use its trunk. It's amazing. I could watch these for hours. Justin has asked us a question about how much a baby elephant weighs at birth. Now, Justin, if I remember correctly, I think it's between 40 and 80 kilograms at birth. Let me just double check here for you quickly. Which is very heavy for a young elephant. I'm almost certain. It can actually be even more than that. So 80 to 120 kilograms at birth, which is, what is that, 250 pounds at birth. Hope my equation is correct. I think that's about right. But yeah, about 120 kilograms, 100 to 120 kilograms at birth. That's a very large calf. A little bit of maintenance going on in the background at Juma. I'm just fixing a roof or two. Can hear a few hammers being knocked. So Satna has asked, why do all these adults have their backs to the water? I don't know, Sally. It's a good question. Why are they all standing like that? I don't think there's a specific reason. Perhaps they are just because they have chosen to hang around this waterhole and allow the younger elephant to drink and explore. Maybe the adults are just keeping a lookout for danger. You know, they elephant, even though they are so large, they are still aware of predators, and they don't really, especially in this area, probably don't have a direct threat, but they are still careful. It could possibly be because they're just having a look around, making sure there are no predators, and letting the youngsters enjoy the water and enjoy exploring the waterhole. But I don't know if there's a specific reason. That would be my guess and my theory. And that one's putting its mouth over the over the stump. This is amazing. That's so relaxed. There's one off to the left, just on the left of the waterhole. You'll see it's dust bathing. Have a look at that, that one right there. Picking up sand with its trunk and throwing it on its back. The reason they do that is often to protect the skin. Get rid of some of the flies or insects that might be sitting on the back. And also to cool it down and protect the skin from the sun, from the harsh sun during the day. In summer especially, when it's very hot, they'll splash mud and water and throw that on their backs. And then now in winter, and also in summer, they'll do it with sand too. I'll throw that, pick it up and throw it over their backs. There we go, look at that. So Lauren has asked a question about the tusks, and I think what we saw with that youngster rubbing its front mouth on the stump. And Lauren has asked, does it hurt when the elephant tusks come through? Is it like teething for us? So Lauren, I'm not sure. I don't know. I mean, it's very difficult to guess. How do we know what pain they are feeling when those tusks are coming through? I do think it may be a little bit uncomfortable. And I think that is why possibly that youngster was just scratching its mouth on the stump. That could be a reason. But I think once they push through a little bit, I don't think it really hurts the elephant. Again, it's a theory, and it's what I think. It's not to say that it is correct. But I do think it may cause a bit of irritation. You can imagine these tusks start forming and pushing underneath the lip or the side of the mouth. But I don't think it's sore. And again, I mean, you know, when you're a youngster or baby, you go through that teething phase and it creates discomfort. But I can't remember it being sore. It was too young. So I think it's similar with some of these animals. Probably causes a bit of discomfort, but I think they handle it a lot better than what we would. Really enjoying all the different questions from everybody from all over the world. And you know, one thing I've realized is that you can be guiding for so long, but you constantly learn new things. And on a daily basis, being out in the bush, I've been guiding for a long time, but still to this day, I'm still learning and seeing things that I've never seen before. And from all these questions and that, it's also a way for me to learn and share some of the knowledge that I have with all of you back home, and hopefully you are all learning from it. But always remember that we learn every day with nature and with wildlife, and we can learn from nature and wildlife. I think the way animals look out for each other, and especially elephant herds, you know, they look after the young. I think it's such a valuable lesson for us to take from them too. A lot of dust being kicked up by those elephants as they move down the embankment over there. What I'm going to do is reposition for us quickly. So a question we have received from X-Blade would like to know, is the elephant the elephant skin stronger than rhino skin, or is it the other way around? Is rhino skin stronger than elephant skin or hide? So, X-Blade, I'm not sure, and I'll tell you why. I've only felt rhino hide and rhino skin. It's very, very thick, very, very tough. But elephant hide is also very thick and tough. I do think, however, that a rhino hide is a little bit thicker and a little bit stronger than elephant. Elephants do have a lot of folds within their hide. You can't really see it at the moment, but if you get really up close to an elephant, you can see little folds in the skin and that. And I think the skin of an elephant is a little bit more sensitive than that of a rhino. How quickly they all decided, right, that's enough. Had enough water, time to move on. The whole herd moves together. It's a lovely, lovely sighting. Great go away birds coming down to drink at the waterhole. Flown off there now. Look at those ellies. It's interesting. They know, I think they know these areas so well. They know where the water is, they know where they're going. Now they're heading off to go and feed for the day. You know, elephants have to constantly feed, they feed for most of the day. Need a lot of fuel to keep those big animals going. And as I mentioned earlier, I'm sure later on during the day they may go and find another waterhole and go and drink. Wasn't that wonderful? So great to see a herd of elephant standing very peacefully, drinking, enjoying the water, and then moving off. And see the interaction and the little things. It was interesting to see how two different elephants put their mouths over the logs that are packed around this waterhole. Very interesting behavior. We're going to carry on. I think what we're going to do is head up towards the quarantine area and see if there's anything up on the clearings over there. Maybe we're lucky and we have one or two buffalo lying around, or herds of impala or zebra maybe. Some impala ahead of us. Look at that. As I said, it's always nice to see impala. I think they are very beautiful antelope. It's a young male in the front and a female behind. The other morning, those of you who had joined us, I was talking about the skin or the hair on the impala. And early in the mornings, we would have seen it this morning if we saw any impala, but we didn't. The hair on the backs, what happens is it looks as if they've been brushed the wrong way. The reason for that is they tense muscles in their skin, causes the hair to raise up, and it traps air underneath, which acts as an insulation layer and keeps them warm in the cold mornings. Now as the day warms up, they relax those hairs and they get that beautiful sheen again. And you can see that coat at the moment. All those impala are shining beautifully in the sunlight. But when you do see them with their hair standing up, then it's very strange. It looks like they've been brushed the wrong way. You can see it very, very clearly. That's great. Well, we've had some luck with antelope this morning. We've had impala, and then we had some kudu earlier. And of course, that inyala with that beautiful newborn baby. That was wonderful. Great morning. Really enjoyed it. Glad it's warming up though. It was chilly this morning. Thank you very much to Brian and the Thumb for keeping me company, doing such a wonderful job with the camera.
Thank you.
And then it was great to finish off with those elephant. Thank you to the ladies in final control, so Kirst and Lou. And my name is Byron again, and we will see you this afternoon for our sunset safari. Have a wonderful day.
Hello, everybody. I'm standing here on a termite mound, surveying the domain where we have driven around today and failed to find any leopards. And this is the last place we saw Sandile. He was wandering down to the right-hand side of where I am now. We've just had tracks of shadow as we came out of Arethusa, and they looked pretty fresh to me, and I think they were heading down in a southerly direction, possibly into Hoffman's here, which is where she's been keeping the cub for quite a long time. Anyway, some prospects for the afternoon. Whoops, the daisies. I'm not sure what we're going to do this afternoon. I haven't decided. But we are going to go and enjoy the rest of our Sunday in the manner of Huckleberry Finn chewing a piece of grass. Right, I'm plugged in again. So we'll drive slowly forward, because on a Sunday one must drive slowly and enjoy the sights of this beautiful winter's day that we have here. I'm glad Byron managed to find those elephants. It was looking a little bleak at one stage, but starting to look better now. And prospects for the morning, at least for the afternoon, very good. All right, everybody, that's going to be it from us. Thank you, VM, for your efforts. Well done. Good job. And we'll see you this afternoon, Byron and I. I'm not sure who's going to be on camera. Big thanks to Byron, of course, being filmed by Brian this morning. And Kirsten in the final control, along with Luisi. Thank you for your efforts, of course. But mostly to all of you, your questions and comments. At 3 o'clock this afternoon, we will see you again. Until then, stay safe and happy, and be merry.